Thank you, Deshpande ji. Fellow named Kiran Kumar, and all of you who have gathered here today on the occasion where Prabuddha Bharat is organizing an event of bringing in people and talking to you about the various activities in the country and the development. And let me thank organizers of Prabuddha Bharat for giving me an opportunity to visit Belgavi again, where now I have become a fairly familiar personality, because in this institution I also got an honorary degree and I have become part of Belgavi. Today what I intend to do is I intend to take you through the technological development that have happened in the country in an area where the world considers this is the fourth frontier, and as humanity keeps developing its capabilities to tackle with the earlier set of frontiers, whether it is land, ocean, air, today we are talking of space as a frontier, and how this frontier of space and what is the kind of technological growth that has happened and how it has helped rapid development in certain aspects of the societal benefits it has brought to the country. Probably all of you are quite familiar that when space technology started its functioning, with the first object being put into space, Sputnik, by the Russians in 1957, we had a great visionary scientist in our country, a person, Dr. Vikram Sarabhai, who saw in this technology an opportunity to make rapid strides in a country which had just got its independence. And as we are all quite familiar, that it's only the developments of science and technology which has provided tremendous tools for improving the quality of life of the society. Dr. Arthur Clarke had shown that if you are able to put an object at a height of 36,000 kilometers, it will appear stationary to Earth and you can do line of sight communication. And Dr. Sarabhai quickly realized that if we can get into this area of space technology, we can make huge strides. And it was his visionary efforts and making use of his friendship with Americans, Russians, French and German scientists, he brought in the form of kits, sounding rockets, to Trivandrum, Tumba Equatorial Rocket Launching Site. And at that place, making use of the services of a priest of a church, he could convince the fishermen of that beach that if you vacate this place today, the work that is being done will one day benefit the country. And starting, and there also he could bring the technology components by convincing the fellow scientists that we have a unique place in this country which is very close to geomagnetic equator, and if you conduct upper atmospheric research, it will be beneficial for the globe. And starting with that kind of assembling a sounding rocket in a dilapidated church premises, we started our space program. And if you look at where we have reached today, just the other day you saw India launching 30 satellites for other countries. And today we have done 271 satellites for 34 countries using a launch vehicle called Polar Satellite Launch Vehicle. And this vehicle can put satellites into multiple orbits and also multiple satellites into orbit. And last year, when we put 104 satellites in one go, actually the entire world turned around and looked at India, looking at what's happening here. On that day night, we had released a video which actually took pictures of each of the satellites being released from the launch vehicle. You can imagine a vehicle which is moving at the speed of almost 22,000 kilometers per hour. Every few milliseconds, it has to release an object such that these objects do not clash with each other, do not collide with each other. It requires a tremendous amount of computational effort to make sure that all these objects go in satisfactory trajectory. And when this video was released, by the next day morning, you had more than 1.5 lakh downloads across 100 countries, indicating to you the kind of curiosity it had generated. And in this, we had one American company which had put 88 of its satellite in this particular 104 satellite constellation. Then in a similar manner, if you look at what we have done with our developed space technology, last year we also had a satellite which launched or which put transponders, which is provided to our neighboring countries, when the Prime Minister had promised earlier the SAARC countries that we will provide satellite transponders to you for free of cost, for usage, for providing weather information, for providing disaster relief information, and also interconnecting them. This is true to our traditional belief that the knowledge you acquire, the skills you acquire, should be not only used for the benefit of the society, but also for the benefit of your fellow countries around you. And it is in this context that what India did of putting SAARC satellite, one of the SAARC satellite, made an impact. And on that occasion, when there was a video conference immediately after the launch of this particular satellite, Prime Minister had made sure that all the heads of these states are participating in a video conference. And in that conference, what the Afghan president said can make you all feel really proud. The Afghan president said, "We are used to people making promises, but this is the first occasion I'm seeing in real quick time a promise has been fulfilled." And that the capabilities that have been established with this kind of a polar satellite launch vehicle not only has put India on the global map, but it has also enabled us to do many activities where people across the world are turning around and looking at us. Few of the examples I would like to give you. Chandrayaan 1, if you look at, man had landed on the moon. A large number of probes have gone around the discovering the process of water molecule formation and presence of water on the moon. The credit goes to Chandrayaan 1. And in a similar manner, the Mars mission, if you look at, the Mars mission, considered one of the very difficult missions, because globally only 40% success rate was there. And when we attempted this in the year 2013, on the 5th of November, when we launched this particular satellite using PSLV, the task cut out for this object was to travel for about 10 months, a distance of 600 million kilometers, and at the end of that period, on a specific day and time, 24th September 2014, morning 7:30 a.m., you imagine a cube of 50 kilometers in space. If this object were not inside that cube at that second, we would have failed in the mission. And what kind of forces could have deviated the satellite? Even sunlight falling on the satellite can produce enough force to deviate its trajectory. And you can imagine that till that time, what we had done was we had put satellites into low Earth orbit up to 1,000 kilometers, geostationary satellites up to 36,000 kilometers, and moon mission, which is about 4 lakh kilometers, whereas Mars is almost 200 million to 400 million kilometers away from Earth, and you needed to travel almost 600 million kilometers from the starting point. And during that entire period, you had to build a technology with which you are able to communicate with the satellite and also build enough intelligence into the satellite, because you can visualize that if you give a command to this satellite, it takes almost 14 minutes to reach it when it is at the farthest point. Even when the light is traveling at 3 lakh kilometers per second, you need almost 14 minutes for the command you give from the ground station to reach it. And you can obviously visualize that any failures it encounters, it would be extremely difficult. So what was done and demonstrated in this made a huge difference to the countrymen and to the entire the globe, because it was in a made a country had put an object around the Mars and succeeded in putting it in the Mars orbit. And when this happened, you can see the kind of enthusiasm and the kind of confidence it generated in the countrymen, because in spite of whatever difficulties you have, you can make things happen if you put in dedicated efforts, what was shown. And not only that, what was shown in this is, while you should definitely learn from your own mistakes, but you can do better if you can learn from others' mistakes. The 40% success rate of other missions and the remaining 60% failures were studied in detail, and we had incorporated some features which were essential for us to succeed in our maiden attempt. And similarly, there is one more satellite of which I would like to apprise you. We built a satellite called AstroSat, which actually carries a number of telescopes operating in different wavelength regions, from visible to far ultraviolet and X-ray. And this satellite makes celestial object observation, transient phenomena. This satellite carries a telescope which has 3 times better angular resolution than the best in the world. And this kind of instrument have been actually realized in our academic institutions within the country, and we enabled institutions like Tata Institute of Fundamental Research, Indian Institute of Astrophysics, Raman Institute, Indian Institute of Science, Physical Research Laboratory. And it was through their efforts that we built these telescopes, and for the first time we were able to put them all together and launched it. And today already it is making a huge impact, because it has also discovered that one of the black holes, which is rotating at a speed almost 0.9 times the theoretical limit, has been verified by this telescope. And it has given an opportunity for our academic researchers and the student community to make use of the data, virgin data, what they call, because most of the other time they had to depend on data from other sources, whereas this satellite is providing the celestial object observation data, whether it is black holes or whether it is gravitational waves studies and many other similar things. And this satellite is a unique combination of a set of telescopes going in a platform. Now, all these capabilities of the space science apart, the fundamental reason why space technology was adopted and used, if I want to narrate to you, you can visualize in the 70s, for example, we had in the country only the 4 metros looking at the broadcasting service or television. That they should lend us an advanced technology satellite, and he was able to convince them and borrow a satellite. And though he passed away in 1971, the actual activity was completed in 75, where borrowing this satellite, moving over to Indian longitude, for about a year, using equivalent of today's direct-to-home television, direct-to-community sets were realized at that time, making use of black and white television sets of Electronic Corporation of India, and the front-end hardware realized in the country at Space Application Center, Ahmedabad. In 2,400 villages of our country, the remotest part, the broadcasting service was provided, giving information to the villagers and the farmer, and telling them about the various farming practices and health information. And this was what convinced the government of India that if India has to make rapid strides in communication, broadcasting, and also in meteorology, it is through the space technology. And in fact, at that point of time in 1975, this was the world's first largest socio-technological experiment conducted by anybody making use of the space technology. What this definitely showed was, while we ourselves had limitations of developing technology or the technological access, definitely we had people who could conceive of bringing in solutions for problems which were prevalent. In the same manner, the technology of satellites was used for communication, where in the 70s we had to wait for a couple of hours after making a person-to-person call booking and waiting in the central telegraph office. The thing changed drastically after the INSAT series of satellite came. And today, for example, if you see, any person can see on his mobile at this instant what is happening anywhere in the world, because the communication revolution that has been brought in by the space technology. And in a similar manner, if you look at the use of space technology for the disaster warning, cyclones, super cyclone, which used to cause havoc of causing deaths of more than tens of thousands. Today, we have a capability where every 15 minutes from geostationary platform, we can look at what is happening on and in and around India in the atmosphere, look at cloud and their patterns, look at microwave wavelength, and look at wind patterns, and then give a prediction through the India Meteorology Department of cyclone landfall with an error less than 20 kilometers in space and half an hour in time, and provide this information days in advance so that disaster relief agencies are able to evacuate people and save lives to the tune of 15,000, which was the loss that used to occur in the earlier decades of super cyclones coming. More than that, one of the applications which we all feel very proud of is, like I said, when Vikram Sarabhai had to convince the fishermen of the Tumba Equatorial rocket launching site, as though to vindicate that, from 1999 onwards, through a process of looking at the color of the ocean and looking at the temperature fronts, we were able to generate what is called a prospective fishing zone information and provide this to the fishermen of the country through Indian National Center for Ocean Information Systems in Hyderabad. And this alone saves to the country between 15 to 20,000 crores a year, because the fisherman can go to the place where he can catch the fish directly without having to search and spend extra petrol and diesel fuel. And to this capability, we have added a very new component in the recent past when we dedicated our navigation satellite constellation. Here again, what was done is again a solution which is very different from what rest of the world adopted. All of you are quite familiar, in your mobiles you see GPS-based navigation system. Americans make use of a constellation of 24 to 32 satellites. Similarly, Russians have GLONASS. Chinese and Europeans are building their constellation of 30 plus satellites. But what we did is we conceived of a 7-satellite constellation, putting them close to geostationary orbit. And then using this constellation, today we are providing to the country in surrounding the boundaries of our country, borders of our country, 1,500 kilometers beyond that, we are in a position to make use of our own receiver gadgets and then get positional information. And this also has a unique messaging system. And using this, a small gadget is fitted into the fisherman's boat, and this gadget communicates with the mobile of the fisherman. The mobile itself need not have any connection with the terrestrial towers, and this device is used only as a display device, and it communicates with him, and he gets in his local language information about any weather vagaries, and also like a compass needle, it points to him where he has to go for fishing. Though the fisherman need not know any reading or writing, you can imagine in his hand there is a tool which communicates to him in his local language, alerting him of weather vagaries, and also in case he is coming very close to any international boundaries, he is alerted, and also in the form of a compass needle, it shows him where to go for fishing. So this is the advantage of technology, and similarly for Coast Guard, the information is used. And today, India, both the central and state governments, departments make use of the space technology-based geospatial inputs for many activities, both in terms of planning and monitoring. A large number of activities like MNREGA, where government spends thousands of crores of rupees. Today, with the help of people working with ISRO, NIC, and also the Ministry of Rural Development, more than 4.5 crore assets have come into the database, and any citizen can look at the Bhuvan platform and see what is happening in a particular location in terms of the MGNREGA activity. In a similar manner, the governments are using it for planning and also for monitoring activities. And today we have about 45 plus satellites which are providing us a capability of looking at Earth in different wavelengths, not only in only visual wavelength where we can see. You can imagine between June and September, we have cloud cover which is preventing observation from satellites. But to overcome that, you can make use of a wavelength called microwave, where cloud is transparent to us, like the through the glass we can see, cloud becomes transparent to this particular wavelength, and you can collect data. And for all this, we have built indigenous launch vehicle capability, indigenous satellite capability, and also applications. While we may be fifth or sixth in many of the launch vehicle technology areas, globally it is recognized that India is among the top countries which has made use of the space technology for bringing in its benefits to the society and to the people at large. And today we have a cryogenic engine capability, two versions of which have been realized, and where liquid oxygen and liquid hydrogen are the fuels. And using these, the technological development that have happened gives India strength among the Committee of Nations. The technological growth that has happened with the efforts of people who have come out of the institutions and universities, not always from the top ranking institutes in the country, but many of the rural students and rural people who have gone through institutions which are other than the top rank. What this definitely shows is, while many of the people who have acquired their skills and knowledge have made use of their skill and knowledge, not exactly directly for the benefit of the country, but some of them have definitely have looked for greener pastures and gone ahead. But then, if today India has to become a truly world-leading country, what has to happen is a change in the working environment, change where people accept each other. One of the problems that we face in the country, why people have gone away from India, is when they are trying to put in their professional capabilities into the activity, they find the environment is not very conducive. They find that they have to struggle through a lot of things before they can start actually putting the technical and professional work into practice. And if this takes away much of their energies, then naturally they will be looking at ways of doing this elsewhere. But things are changing, and gradually, as the country is becoming more and more economically strong, people who have gone out want to come back and then contribute their might to the development of the country. And today, if you look at technological capabilities, the space, like I was telling, is a fourth frontier. Globally, there is tremendous opportunity. This is one area where India has made a huge impact. And if we have to take the benefit of this by providing solutions to the problems of the technological growth elsewhere, we need to improve, we need to build capacity within the country. And that's what ISRO is trying to do by bringing in a new area of capacity building program office and trying to engage with industries and academic institutions. We are trying to bring in and provide the data that is collected in institutes like National Remote Sensing Center and Space Application Center, Ahmedabad, where researchers are being provided opportunity and exposure to spend time there. They have access to the entire data that is collected. They can go through their research activities and bring in solutions. While what we have done is significant, it is not adequate, and we need to do a lot more. And this can only happen when more and more people from the industry and from the academic institutions come out, and then they start using the tremendous opportunity that exists in this arena of space technology. Space technology which can give benefit, it is essential, because it's only when you go far away from Earth you can really see the whole mechanism of what is happening, whether it is climate change or whether it is glacial changes or whether it is looking at places where you don't have access from ground. And this is a huge opportunity here, and I'm sure with more and more academic institutions and industries trying to take up this process of bringing in the solution of technological capability for addressing the problems of our country moves ahead. So let me take this opportunity to thank Prabuddha Bharat for giving me a small occasion to come here and tell you about what India has done and the tremendous scope that it has got and tremendous future India has. And truly in the coming years, not only will we be reaching the place of third largest economy, but also reaching the so-called Vishwaguru, which was the heritage or which was the original position of India for thousands of years. Thank you.